What's up, guys? We're gonna start this video here, backing up out of our garage because we got something to show y'all. So as many of y'all know, we ended up upgrading our shock to 14.5 inches. So we got that super duper gap. I mean, look at that. But at this point, you're probably like, dude, what's on your swing arm? Well, since upgrading to that size shock, an unintended issue that we've been having is the chain slack that we have set it right now. We recently just troubleshooted a lot of stuff to start making our marks, because after we installed the shock, we set the chain slack to 1.5 inches, which is what your spec is for your Harley, for your belt, and then the chain, you want to be in the same, in a similar area. You just treat it like a belt. And after a couple rides with the new shock, thinking it was all as good as new, I noticed that the chain was slacking a little bit, and because it had a noticeable kind of dip to it, and it didn't look like insane sag, but I knew it was more than what was spec'd. So we came home, measured it, and it was about 2.5 inches. Like, Jesus. We ended up loosening the axle nut. We pushed everything back, readjusted our adjusters, everything, set it back at 1.5 inches, went for a ride. Well, after about an 80-mile ride, we noticed that it was the same thing. It was about 2 inches, 2.5. I go, dude, that's so strange. Is something not working in the back end? And so I set it again, and then it went to 2.5 inches. Like, okay, you know, let me leave it for a little bit. And then after another ride, it was about 3 inches. I go, dude, what? That was really starting to kind of sketch me out. And so I decided, let me go ahead and redo it one last time. I did it at 1 inch because I was getting aggravated. So I said, I'm going to make sure it really stretches. And it could just be because the chain is stretching itself at a new angle, that at 1.5 inches, it might be too tight. So it's stretching it and causing it to sag to 2, 2.5 inches. Maybe that time I set it to 1, it really stretched it out. But on our axle point, ignore the marking right now, that we're about the center of where the axles, you can see almost about, it might be difficult to see, but even amount of spacing on both ends. And I guess it's going to be a micro adjustment of if it's any different, but it looks like the axle is still in the very center, so we still have some room to grow with the chain. And so that's okay, I don't mind that, but it's just that the increase of sag is what's kind of has me on alert. Because if we were to go on, say, a 500 mile ride with this bike, is it going to continue to sag to 3 inches, to 3.5, to 4? And then also we have so much slack that it causes it to slap, and it may miss teeth, it may bunch up, it may cause rear tire to lock up, and worst case scenario, high side. And then worst case to that worst case, you do that in the middle of a turn, or you also do that in the middle of traffic, which causes you to fall, and then now you're playing Frogger on the middle of the interstate, and that's what we're not wanting to do. And so on this side, we did the exact same thing. We added tape because we didn't have a silver Sharpie. That would be an ideal set, we can mark it down the line. And then we're just going to see if there's any movement after a quick ride. We're going to go for about 100 miles today. It's been about an hour or 2 hour riding of our traditional. And we're going to go to our local favorite road because that puts a good amount of stress on the bike. The main issue that we've been having is trying to figure out the new angle that we're at now, because a quick little thing before we hit the road, that on the bike, the wheel sits almost directly beneath the fender, and on your stock soft tail, you'll see that the rear tire will kind of be, that the rear fender will come down, and then the tire will be somewhere here, and it'll kind of push it out a little bit and then go down. But now we're actually sucked into the fender a little bit more, because since lifting the bike, now the rear tire sits a little bit lower, and it's changed the angle of the chain. So now it kind of has to bring this down our trajectory. So that may be the increase in sag that we're seeing, that maybe that's the new home, is gonna be 2 to 2.5 inches. We set it at 2 to see if it increases any more. And then I think after this, we're gonna let it run for a little bit. There is no movement, and that is set at 2.5 after we go ride. We'll try setting it 2.5 inches as the initial sag, or maybe 2.25. So that way we see if there's a happy medium in there, because even at 2.5, even at 2 inches, I feel like that's a little bit more sag than needed. But again, it's the angle playing into a direct effect, because the front sprocket is somewhere here in the center, and then now you see our rear sprocket is a lot lower. And while we're gonna go rip, it's been a while since we've done kind of just shoot the breeze and ride video. So that's what today is gonna be. And look, we even have notes, buddy. But before we do, y'all, we hit a milestone on the old IG. We are at 10,000 now. We have that K behind the followers. So I'm not sure what that really means, but we were close to it. That's pretty dope. So again, thank you to everyone who follows, who supports the channel and the IG. That's super dope. So we're headed over to the QT to get some gas before we meet up with old Isaac to go rip. He's looking out for our best interest as well, because he knows that we've been dealing with that chain sag issue, and he doesn't want us to
go rip around. In the event that, again, that worst case scenario happens where the sag continues to go, we get some major chain slap, and then next thing you know, we lock up and just hit the ground hard, go unconscious. High side, worst case, but we could also low side. Oh, dude, this is my favorite part right here, because you go one, two. Woo, buddy, that was a little baby bunny hop. And one time I did that and I hit too much gas where I kind of wheelied, and then I went, oh. So we have yet to get a really dope one, but that's my favorite thing to do on the bike. That just blop the throttle, pop the clutch on those little bumps, because then you just get a nice little hop. Anyway, that we have a video for y'all today. We're going to talk about a couple things, and with the 10,000 followers on Instagram, it kind of had me thinking about the YouTube channel and where we're at, where we're going. Since we just hit that 10K, I figured we would get a little nostalgic and don the OG vest. That it's crazy how much weight we've lost, because this thing is huge on me now. It's just amazing where we were, because I didn't even know that we were a little bit overweight, and then we just started changing up our diet, where we stopped eating so much fast food, and we incorporated intermittent fasting to our diet. And that was it, you know, just some sort of activity, like where we would walk. I told myself I would at least jump rope 1 minute a day. And then from there, I kind of grew into going back into the gym. And then one thing that I made sure of was every Friday, I just picked my Fridays to walk 4 miles. I would just walk around my local area, and it was about a 2 mile walk that I would do. But then I would just go down a road, come back, that'd be like an extra half mile. And then I would just circle back around, and that would end up being 4 miles. And just walking, you know, kind of at a decent pace. You're not like running, you're not fast walking, but that made a huge difference. And now we're back at where I think we were like in college. So we're back at a 32 waist, like, yo, what up? Because we were kind of pushing 36 and we were about to bump over to 38. And I was like, ah, no, let's just make some changes. But coming back, okay. So the difference, there's one major difference, and it's really heartwarming when people message, because I posted that we're close to 10K. I think we're at 9,980 or something. I was like, dude, we're actually pretty close. So I posted something on my story on Instagram. Hey, can we get to 10,000? It would mean a lot if y'all would share and so forth. And many of y'all did, and that means a lot to have some of y'all invested. And I truly think of this as kind of a collective. So video quality versus viewers. That recently, I think YouTube had another algorithm pop up, like maybe a couple months ago, where on average, when we first would upload a video, we would probably see, you know, maybe 1,000 views within the first 24 to 48 hours. We're not crazy baking the bank on numbers, but that was our normal. And within the last couple of months, we have videos that have been up for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and we're at only, I think, 200 for some, 600 for another, maybe 1,000 for one or two. I mean, they're few and far between, and we're not chasing the views, but just understand that in order for the channel to continue to grow, that's kind of something that goes hand in hand. So, and I always get a lot of messages on, you know, if I post something on Instagram, like a short edit for Instagram, from which is a clip from one of the videos I post on YouTube, I'll have a couple people message saying, dude, I don't know how you don't have any more viewers. And now that we got the drone, we did that one with the Pelican 1606 bag that we just added. That's gonna be our camping bag. I've linked it in the information box that you can check it out. Intro, that someone had said, I deserve more likes and so forth, which, you know, part of me kind of wishes for that, but at the same time, also, I can improve on my cinematic quality for me, because sometimes I do get lazy, and like I color graded the intro, and proper procedure kind of or proper practice would have been to continue to color grade, maybe not that intense with a LUT in as we did in the intro, but, you know, add a little bit more contrast, bring out the shadows, but at the same time darkening the blacks and adding just a little tonal color grade to it. But I just said, no one's gonna notice that we did that on a couple of videos, and it wasn't the greatest color grading for, I think it was the ones we were in San Antonio as a B&B. No one really appreciated it, and it was kind of like, it almost felt like a slap in the face. But at the same time, we started kind of really caring for the views or for the satisfaction or for the gratification, satisfaction of everyone, like, you know, pointing that out. And I said, no, we started doing this because we got joy from it. When Instagram was first 15 second clips, 20 second clips, whatever it was, that we would go spend like 5 hours, say it was this road, we spend 5 hours on this road, and we would have a chin mount POV, and then we would have, that looks like it moved, and then we would have a, like, we'd put the GoPro here on the floor, and we'd ride by it, park it again, and we would add multiple POVs just for a 20 second clip.
And I truly enjoyed that. And so it's kind of like trying to stay within our roots. And there is a little bit of bitterness at times that some of these other channels, they do a lot less work for their quality of video. I mean, granted, the content may be solid, maybe 10 out of 10, which is some areas where I lack, like, say, unboxing videos. We're still trying to get better at that. The technical side of products, I'm not really there. That's not my
forte, where, you know, so we may be talking about, let's say, the two-wheel audio system. Pretty much what I bring to the table is I enjoy it, I like it, it's loud, and, you know, there's some areas where I feel it could be improved upon, or if there was an area where I felt it could have been improved upon, I would have just addressed that. But as for the technical, like where it has this much amp speakers, or the amp is this much at this wattage, you can allow this, that's not really me. We tried that with the iPhone, I think it was the 11 or the 10, and man, it was just a terrible video. We tried it, and then we did another one with the Galaxy Note, where instead of trying to be what others are, we applied it to how we use it, and I showcased how I edited photos for Instagram, and I did enjoy that. If you look at a lot of these channels with video content where they talk about color grading or how to shoot B-roll, a lot of those have amazing content, as well as the quality of the content, where they have amazing color grade, insane intros, so much invested, but yet the view counts of the videos are like 4,000, and then their subscriber counts like maybe 200. Some are like 10,000, 20,000, a couple hundred thousand, but where they put out so much great information, but yet it's not there. And then some other videos, then some other channels, they just use the basic GoPro, they grab it, they hold it, you know, as their B-roll camera. And again, it also depends on how much you're gonna invest into it versus how much you wanna get out of it. That we have a lot invested into the channel because we've always enjoyed creating content. And we're continuously improving because we have a lot of stuff that makes things a lot easier, but it's not needed. Like our DSLR camera, we got it because we wanted to add depth of focus and the ability to change focal lengths with, let's say, a prime lens versus a zoom lens, and it allows us to capture a lot more with photography as well as videography. We have a boom mic that sits on top of our camera because we want a crisper audio versus having our external recorder, which was the Tascam DR05, and then plugging it in our pocket and then having it inside our shirt, and we would have to sync the audio and video at the end. But you can do, there's ways to do that a lot easier. Like you can have those markers, or you can clap really loud, or even yell. That way you can match the audio waves and the video waves and the audio from the video waves together, and that gets you closer. But I wanted to be able to incorporate the audio directly into the video, so that way I didn't need to. If I choose to just use the video, I'll just mute the audio, or if I just choose to use the audio, I'll just turn the opacity on the video down, so that way you only get the audio but you won't get the video, and you can overlay, you can play around with stuff like that. And I thought that was really interesting. So there is that. And sometimes I do feel discouraged, but then at the same time, you know, coming back to, we'll get the views when we get them, that, you know, maybe it hasn't been our time to hit that YouTube gold rush per se. That there are tons of great videos, don't get me wrong,
and at the same time, the content that we're putting out, it can be pretty stagnant at times, where it's like, you know, so many unboxing videos or so many product reviews. And it's funny because at the same time, just know that most of the stuff you see comes from our own pockets.
That recently on a Cena video, someone had commented, when are YouTubers, and we could probably pull it up, but essentially it's, when are YouTubers gonna realize that we don't wanna hear certain things? And they were talking about how I was emphasizing on how the music sounded, and I think I played a couple songs and talked about that, where that's how I use it most often when I'm not using the two-wheel audio, or we'll communicate, and we do need to add an update video on how the comm system works with them, because but I rarely use them, so I didn't feel the need to touch base on that. But again, that is a shortcoming that we can improve upon. But just the way he phrased it was kind of like, really, where I wanted to comment, hey bud, GoPros cost this much, YouTube to sign up is free, you already have an account because I see you have your name established, you have your photo on it, you know, you could, and then the scenic costs $300, go ahead and buy it, do a review. That a lot of times I just let it roll off my shoulder because they're few and far between. But during that week, I think it might have been 4 or 5 comments between Instagram and YouTube that I was just like, what? So they kind of stood in the forefront, and I was just like, whoa, bro, are we finally at that level? Do we have clout now where we just have regular haters? And I've been blessed with that, that the community that comes to check out the channel is really open, and they understand that there are certain things that we're not good at. Because it was also funny, because someone else messaged, once we got the shock, they said, why do you need that? And I go, because I wanted it. You know, I didn't need it. I wanted it. I wanted that height in the back. And they continued to question. I was like, I don't really need to explain myself to you. And I just said, for clearance. And then I posted about a slipper clutch, that I was looking to get a slipper clutch. And again, the same person has messaged me throughout the several months. And a lot of times it's just kind of, you know, it is a little annoying, but I don't pay much mind to it. But then there was just this week that everything was kind of there. And I was like, you know, I'm kind of annoyed, and I'd really rather not deal with this. And so I said, for my type of writing, you know, I'm looking into it. I feel I would benefit from it. And then he proceeded to question, and I was just kind of, and essentially I was enabling him by engaging in this conversation, because he could tell I was getting short. And so I said, because I ride a lot of high RPMs, and then I'll engine brake a lot. And with that, if you are a high RPM and you downshift too far low a gear, so say we're in fourth at 5,000 RPM, we downshift to fourth, you know, you may feel a quick little, but if I go from fifth to third and I was at 5,000 RPM and I just quickly do it and pop the clutch, then most than likely your rear tire is going to lock up. It's either going to cause you to slide, it may just bite and then just flip you over. There are some dangers that goes with that, but you can also get good at it. But what I'm looking to do with the slipper clutch, it's the same concept, but it allows you to do such more violent maneuvers without really messing up your clutch basket or locking up your wheel, because it essentially just slows down the clutch basket instead of just quickly, just whatever speed it is, it tries to kind of match it. You don't need a rev match with a slipper clutch versus with your more conventional clutch. And that way you can back it in. So say we're going like 200 miles an hour here and we want to make this turn, we can drop it into second, and then all of a sudden our rear tire, and then you kind of just back it in, kind of what the supermotos do, or MotoGP will do in some cases. And it just, you know, I felt like I would benefit from it. But then all of a sudden, here comes Mr. Opinion saying, you don't need that, you know, you're not a fast enough rider, I'm the fastest there is, you know, let's race. And I said, all right, dude. And it did make me chuckle. I did find it amusing, but he was dead serious. I said, I don't ride that aggressively on the street, because there's a lot more dangers about, like, I mean, you have fences, you have trees, you have sharp metal objects, and then if it's nighttime and you're racing, you wipe out, and all of a sudden you're in the road, because like, we're wearing dark jeans, we're wearing a camo, I mean, it is white kind of with gray, but at night no one's gonna see us till it's too late, till they hit the boom boom, oh what was that, and then, oh honey, you ran over someone, and it's like, oh bro. And I don't want that. So I'd really rather not have to put myself in that danger, because I don't need to. And, but he kept on trying to bring me to go race. And then I told him, well, I'll be at the racetrack with, you know, for the Harley, for the cruiser track day. If you really want to race, you know, swing on out there. That's where I'll be. And
then he continued to, you know, be machismo and try to like, oh, I only do it for bets. And I said, well, all right. You had mentioned that you wanted a race. I gave you an avenue. I gave you a date, a general time frame, because it's March. We don't have the exact date. And then he was just like, no, you know, I only do it for bets. And they go, well, you're the one that's talking about this, so you'll know where I'll be. And then long story short, after I realized that I was enabling him to be obnoxious and annoying, that I just said, all right, cool, whatever, you know, that you focus on your riding, I'll focus on mine. my funds fund my bike. I was still trying to be polite in some way, but I pretty much just, but I did say, you worry about your riding, I'll worry about mine. And then he proceeded with another comment saying I was socialized, and I just left it at that. I said, thumbs up, cool. And now anytime he does decide to engage, I just leave it on red. There's no point in investing that type of energy to that. So I said, you know, wash my hands of it, said adios. So yeah, a lot of stuff that we get is from, you know, we do have some, we are blessed with the ability to have partnerships and sponsorships with such amazing great companies. We have Memphis Shades that's been on board since we had the Dyna, and that's been the same fairing since. That's 60,000 miles, probably even 70,000. We have Trask Performance. That was not sponsored, but we were allowed the opportunity to purchase them at a slightly lower cost than what's full retail. And then Curiakin has been an amazing, amazing partner to be working with, because they're also working with the photography business, Care Digital Media, and that's really helping us get on board with some other companies. Hardcore Cycles has been one that we've been working with for a while. That the partnership has been invaluable. It's been able to bring y'all the video on the Legend Suspension Air Ride shock, as well as this Russ Warnemont shock. And we're keeping them up to date with any issues that we have with the shock, because we did go so tall. And then, of course, and then also Elite Terrain Innovations that did afford us this new bag setup that we were able to kind of play with and see just how adaptive and customizable, is that a word, that they can be. Because with the Pelican 1606, we said, can we do it? Let's try it. And we tried it and it worked. So that's pretty dope. Quick little plug. Be sure to check out all the links in the drop-down section below, because those also help directly fund the channel, where the links to the Amazon, we are part of the Amazon affiliate links, and anytime you do select one of those links, that we do get a portion of that revenue. Or if, say, you click on one of the links, but you don't purchase that item because, say, you don't do motorcycles, but your wife asks you to buy diapers, what you can do is click on that link, go buy that set of diapers in the Amazon, just search something diapers, you buy that, we'll still get a percentage of that, and that directly helps out the channel, as well as we have some items on the Teespring. What? We're back. We are back. We just finished a quick rip with Isaac. Shout out to him for coming out and keeping us company while we went for our test ride to ensure that the chain isn't adding any more sag. From what I can tell, it doesn't look to be any increased sag, and I think that may just be what we need to do, is instead of keeping it within 1.5 inches with for the spec, we're gonna have to do 2 inches. We're gonna head back home right now. Hopefully we don't get rained on. And then just check the measurement to see if it's at 2.5. And at that point, we'll know that it moved up 0.5 inch. And then we'll just readjust it, put it at 2.25, and see if it continues to do that. And then if so, we'll just see if it goes to 2.5 inches. And then after that, if that continues to kind of go back to 2.5, we may just set it 2.5, and that may be just where we need to go. And anything past 2.5, we'll know that the chain is stretching with normal wear and tear. And I think that's just what we're gonna have to expect, since we did go so tall in the rear, more than what was intended. Final thoughts. We did touch base on some of the products that we get that we have been purchasing, and to kind of reiterate on that and touch base back onto the initial investment of what we have into this channel and to where it is right now with the views, that we are getting a couple more subscribers here and there, but with the new YouTube algorithm, if there is one, something has happened where it's caused a shift in views, where we only get so many views per video, and right now we're averaging about 300 to 500 after about a week. And we had posted on the YouTube feed, kind of like what would be a feed post with text, etc., of us saying that we had ordered winter gear, which we did. We ordered a ton of stuff that ended up equaling about $700. And to make a long story short, that when I placed my order, we ended up going through a firm because it was a lot. I didn't feel like dropping that much cash, but I knew I wanted to invest in winter gear because I have always wanted to. And so I ended up checking with the firm once it said, oops, an error, went right when I check out, when I put submit order, and then it said, a firm said, well, the merchant received it, they're processing it. And when I went back to this website, it showed that I had placed the order and then they were processing it as well. It said order received. And so I thought that was it. And then a few days later, I just wanted to double check, because previously I had an issue with my address, that according to their website, the way I put my address everywhere else, even USPS, UPS, everywhere, that their system said, this is a wrong address, it doesn't exist, just because I didn't use the second address line to put APT for apartment.
and then my apartment number. And so I was just like, okay, cool. It's like, so I went ahead and went and was proactive on this one, called them just to make sure. And I had my order number at that point because I just read it off the order query. And they said, oh yeah, we received it. Everything's good to go. You should be getting an email stating that your shipment will be that your order will be shipped very soon. So I said, all right, dope. And then a few days passed, it was about 3 or 4, and I hadn't received anything. So I was just curious because we are pretty impatient when it comes to ordering stuff. And then I couldn't find my order on this company's website. And I was just like, what's going on? So I called them and I say, hey, I can't find my order. The guy asked me, hey, what's your order number? I go, I can't find my order number. I just said that. And he ended up finding it and said, oh, there's no issue, that there was an issue with your address, but it's been resolved. I go, I was told that there wasn't an issue. And then fast forward that he said everything was fixed. It should go over to logistics and we should be placing that order very soon. And I was looking forward to this gear, so because I had a trip planned in colder weather. So that was just kind of, and then I get an email the following week on a Monday morning. First email to shoot out that I saw was, your order has been canceled. These are the items you won't be billed for. And it was all those items. It was like 6 or 7 items, which was gonna include the battery powered gloves, an extra battery, the full suit that was a thermal suit, and a bunch of other items. And I was just like, what? Yeah, so it was kind of like they told me that there was no issue with my apartment when there in fact was there was an issue the second time I called. And then they said that the order was fixed and I would be receiving the order, it would be getting shipped, etc., which it wasn't. I'll be looking into this. And this was just kind of like, okay, well, you know what, so I hit them up and said, is there any way you can just go ahead and release the funds, because according to a firm, they were still holding on to it and they were still processing it, even though on their end it showed my order had been canceled from this company and not a firm. And so I said, please, please, please just go ahead and release them. I've had so many issues with y'all and this is just kind of the last straw, so just please help me out with this. And the guy was super helpful. He understood kind of my despair and just aggravation, and he said, all right, let me get my manager on this. They ended up releasing the funds. And another thing that was kind of tying into that, because, and then I started kind of browsing, like, is this really worth it at this time to invest this much money into the channel when, again, there isn't much return on our end? And a lot of times, and I do like bringing y'all items that I use and actually put to its paces, but this would have been kind of one of those things where, yeah, we would have used it just one winter. And there aren't many videos out there aside from like Revzilla cycle gear on these, and they're mostly just fitment and a couple, oh, these work. But I wanted to bring an actual review of us, right? Because we were going to be going to West Texas in January, which is about 40 degree weather for 8 hours out, and then we're going to be camping. It's about 30 degrees. And I wanted to wear all that to test it to see just how it really holds up to the elements in your everyday riding for like long cruises, city cruises, because we wanted to also bump up our riding for the winter. But after we revisited kind of the logical side of it, that I said, it's not really worth it. Let's go ahead and just not invest in this gear for this channel. And at that point, we were also browsing for drones, which is the drone that we got. Eventually, we ended up reinvesting that money towards that drone because I can get more return out of it, kind of return of investment, as we've been mentioning, from the business. I essentially just need to find 12 clients for aerial photography for their real estate for $100, and then the drone's paid off. So while we're at it, if you are in the Central Texas area, whether it be Austin, Georgetown, New Braunfels, the Texas Hill Country, and you are a realtor, real estate agent, or know someone who is looking for some photography, let me know. So again, yeah, the winter gear, I really want to. So if you do want to see more gear more frequently, be sure and hit the like buttons, and also be sure and comment. That is going to help with the YouTube algorithm, showing them that there is interest, there is engagement. It's going to help push these videos in front of more persons to want to watch. And then again, also do it on the videos that you truly enjoy, because again, that is also going to help me gauge what y'all are interested in seeing, whether it be just kind of like these shooting the breeze videos, or if you enjoy the how-tos or the product review videos. And that will go a long way for the channel overall. And then if you enjoy something, share it across the platforms, whether it be on Instagram, just say, this is a cool video, check it out. It could be a screenshot or even just a screen record, and or share it in your local Facebook group. And that way it'll also help drive that traffic up, and you'll be helping out the channel tremendously. And if you want to show some monetary support, we talked about the Amazon affiliate links. Be sure and click on those links. We're also on Ko-Fi and Patreon. All the links are in the drop-down section below. Whatever monetary compensation you're looking to support with, I'm extremely grateful. On Ko-Fi, it's gonna be more of a blog where we can write on. And Patreon, we are still trying to set up a Patreon exclusive newsletter that's gonna be for y'all, by y'all. That's it. That's going to do it for this week's video. It was definitely an interesting one because we had a lot on our mind that we want to talk about. And we just don't really do these shooting the breeze videos much anymore. And let me know if you want that to change. That we're also, I also plan on incorporating some of the fellas in on some more videos. It's going to be for the next stop. If you want to check out that page on Instagram, just do the nextstop.travel. And that's going to be another blog style where we go out and explore restaurants, good eats, and then local spots that we check out. That scared the shoot out of me. Like gas stations or cool landmarks that, or really cool landmarks. As always, I appreciate y'all checking out the videos. If you enjoyed it, hit that like button. If you found any value from it, hit that subscribe button. And remember to share these videos, comment down below to help us get us in the forefront of other videos. I truly appreciate y'all. And until next time, cheers, ride safe. Later, y'all.